So you already introduced the first session, first slide, first item. Dora is the main organizer of this event. I'd like to thank her very much. In case we run out of the recession, so let's thank her right now. This event responds to several of you who suggested it would be nice to get some diplomatic representative and some business representation from those countries where we are dealing with. So this is what we have done. I will be first talking about Poland in a comparative perspective, and the logical comparison, of course, is Hungary. Then followed by Charles, marketing approaches. Then you see trade relations between Poland and Hungary. Investment experience is a case study. And then, to repeat what Dora said, a few concise questions after each presentation, and then a more general discussion afterwards. Okay. Here is my presentation outline. And what you will note is that most of the facts and interpretations are already covered in this class in different contexts. So now I am pulling those, and let's focus on Poland and Hungary. So some of the slides will be familiar. Legacy's initial conditions in 1989, when the transformation started. During the first decade, Hungary was clearly leading Poland and all the other Central East European countries in transition. I will give the evidence and the reasons. And since 1999, Poland and also others have caught up and overtaken Hungary, and I will provide the evidence and offer a few reasons. And finally, to make use of Dora's excellent homework assignment, we'll present again the comparative business environments of Poland and Hungary as revealed by the World Bank Doing Business and the World Economic Forum's Global Competitiveness Report. Remember the legacy's initial conditions. You remember these two charts, but for those of you who don't, who were not there, okay, initial conditions come from a book that I co-authored many, many years ago, comparing this particular chart, how prepared was a country to move toward the market economy? Preparedness means how many reforms, how many modifications of the traditional centrally planned economy they have undertaken. And the other one here is macroeconomic disequilibrium, which shows the extent of open and repressed inflation in the countries. And you see, just focused on Hungary and Poland, that Hungary and Poland, not too far away, preparedness to move to a market economy, because of agricultural reforms in Poland in 1957, most of agriculture was private. It was a little bit ahead, but Poland was way behind in terms of macroeconomic disequilibrium, high, open, and repressed inflation. And this other chart shows, again, the same preparedness to move to a market economy and the degree of structural misdevelopment. And you see, again, here, the greater the misdevelopment, the more difficult the transition. Again, Poland behind Hungary. Now, so the starting point, 1989, Poland was at a major disadvantage. It had high triple-digit open and some repressed inflation. Hence the shock therapy. Poland is known for the shock therapy, which really just meant to bring the inflation under control very quickly. It did not mean what many people misunderstood then and still, that Poland tried to do all the transformation quickly, all at once. And IMF helped Poland at that time, gave a large standby credit, which was not drawn down, and the stabilization program was really successful. More misdevelopment than Hungary, a higher share of heavy industry. Delayed privatization. The reason for that is solidarity's important role. Solidarity, labor union based, and so on, was not very happy about quick privatization. So Poland, this was moved very slowly, much slower than in Hungary. But both Hungary and Poland enjoy similar methods. The most important method was direct sale, in the case of Hungary, mostly to foreigners. And the second method was MEBO, which stands for Management Employee Buyout. Poland had a slight advantage, or was about the same as Hungary, with respect to market-oriented reform. This is so important because the more traditional, closed, Stalinist command economy a country had, the more difficult then the transformation procedure. So, conclusion here, during the first decade, Poland was ahead. Since 1999, sort of the second decade, Poland gains and then overtakes Hungary. And now I want to, a few pieces of evidence on what is the case. You remember this chart? This is purchasing power parity per capita GDP and the expenditures as percentage of GDP. And you see that as a general rule, we have already gone over this chart before, the higher the level of per capita GDP, the larger in Europe, and anyway, in Europe, the higher is the share of government. And Hungary was and remains a big outlier. Hungary's government expenditures already in 2007 and still matches sort of the level that a Denmark, a Finland, a French, or a Sweden really could afford. And look at that, Poland also may be a little bit above the line, but not that much. So huge role of government, which is now being reinforced by the current government, which is taking over a lot of business, believing that the state can do a better job, which of course is questionable. Here's another chart. Again, you have seen this. Annual budget deficit as percent of GDP. Sorry, this is another language, but let me tell you, the red is Poland and the black is Hungary. And look, from 1989 until Hungary was forced by almost going bankrupt, Hungary's much higher government budget deficit than Poland. So much so that when Lehman Brothers collapsed and the global crisis came, Hungary was on the verge of bankruptcy and so had to go to the IMF, which insisted then tighten your belt, and suddenly, quicker than the other countries, had to reduce its budget deficit. So here is the overspending, which is not unrelated to the high share of government in GDP. Here is the share of foreign currency loans by household. This, by the way, the share of foreign currency in the loans that households are taking out is quite a bit of function of the exchange rate regime of the country. And so it would not be fair to compare Latvia, Estonia, and so on with Poland, because these countries had a different exchange rate regime where it made sense to borrow in euros and so on. But Poland and Hungary had identical exchange rate regimes. And again, you see from a very low start, more than 70% of the loans household took out was in foreign currency. And this is all due to the government policy. You remember we discussed it briefly in class, but I don't have time now to go over it. And for Poland, it started at a higher level, but it sort of kept it reasonably under control. Here is the, again, a chart you have seen. All the European countries' government public debt to GDP ratios. On the left, Western Europe, on the right, Eastern Europe. And again, you cannot compare one to one because higher level of development is easier to carry and so on. So let's just focus on Eastern Europe. And you see that Hungary, by far the largest in 2007 and 2009 and 2011, and still Hungary is about 80% of the public debt to GDP ratios. And for Poland, it is, you know, under the 60% domestic. Poland was able to keep domestic criteria, okay? Also, who owns the foreign debt is important. For Hungary, more than 60% of Hungary's public debt is in foreign hands. of Poland's relatively smaller public debt, less than 50% is held by non-residents. And again, I'm showing this, the chart. Here is Hungary, you see one of the highest, and here is Poland. But I said that what share is held by foreigners depends very much on the exchange rate regime. If you tie your currency to the euro, as the Latvian countries and Bulgaria and so on, it makes sense, therefore, also to borrow in euro. But if your exchange rate fluctuates, it's very dangerous, of course, to do that. So again, Hungary in this respect performed worse. Here is unit labor cost. Unit labor cost 2001 to 2008, before the crisis or during the crisis. And this shows how much more labor unit labor costs increased as compared to unit labor costs in the US. And you see that in Poland, unit labor cost increased very little, about the same as the US. The US also had very little increase in unit labor. Low inflation and reasonably high productivity improvements keeps the unit labor cost low. But look at Hungary, you see, not one of the worst, but unit labor costs have increased about three times faster than in the US, which meant Hungary losing competitiveness. Okay, now here is the total growth rates. Growth rates, again, Hungary is the black line, and Poland is the staggered red line. This one here is Poland. So you see, whereas from 1999 to 2012, Poland increased total GDP by more than 60%. In Hungary, it's less than 30%. So again, it shows that. And then finally, again, a chart you have seen, a table you have seen. Poland was the only country in all of Europe, the only country which was able to avoid a decline in GDP during the Great Recession. Poland, the only country remaining in a positive territory, whereas every other country here and in Western Europe showed a decline. Now, what are some of the reasons for Poland doing better than Hungary? I think, to be fair, these total GDP comparisons have to interpret it very carefully, because total GDP also reflects population changes. And Poland has had a pretty good population increase, whereas Hungary's population has been stagnating or declining. Also helpful for Poland was its lower foreign trade participation ratio. During the Great Depression, when Western Europe and the global economy suffered so much, not being so dependent on foreign trade was helpful for Poland as compared to Hungary, much more dependent on foreign trade. And I would say, I just said, I'm going to say only one slide, not go into, we had a long discussion about Hungary, so on, so don't need to go into long details. But you see, I would say that on balance, these things are sort of outside the government's control. But this thing is not outside the country's control. On balance, Poland's political culture has been much less dysfunctional than Hungary's. Notice how I'm forming it, because people can argue, well, Poland also has political culture problems and so on, but clearly Poland had a much less dysfunctional political culture. I remember 6 months ago an interview by the Polish finance minister, who is a professor here at Central European University on leave, and was asking, how do you explain Poland's good performance? And he said, well, one of the factors is that our opposition and the government are getting along much better than in many other countries. So to give an example, some legislative proposals do receive opposition support. Can anybody in Hungary remember a time in recent memory when any government proposition received the opposition support? I do not remember. And as Balcerowicz, who was visiting here a few months ago, said, in Poland there is no anti-IMF, no anti-Brussels, no anti-multinational company propaganda by the government. In Hungary there is. So I think that this is just a few things that take away, that explain economically and politically and so on, why Poland has performed and why Hungary has been fallen behind during this past decade or so of the other Central East European countries. And to conclude my presentation, I am plagiarizing Dora, the organizer of this conference, who one of the homework did an excellent job in comparing Poland's and Hungary's business environments using on the first doing the World Bank Doing Business report. And here, the higher the number, the lower the ranking of that country among the 185 or whatever nations being compared. So you see that in Poland, getting construction permits, Poland is doing very poorly. I am interested in the TriGranit representative who says has an FDI project in Poland. I think it's a construction project. Any comments that he might want to make? And also getting electricity and so on difficult, registering property more difficult than in Hungary. So overall, the two countries have about the same ranking in doing business, but in this respect, Poland is in worse situation and Hungary protecting investors. This is the big problem. And also, the other chart will show it. So this is a business environment based only on the 10 indicators, not comprehensive. And this is the Global Competitiveness Report, GCR. We showed that the countries, Hungary is the 60th and Poland is the 41st. So here, the higher the number, the more you are moving toward the optimum border. The optimum border is 7, so on. So here you see that Poland is generally, except in a few areas, is doing better than Hungary. And what are sort of the worst situations for Hungary? Well, you will see, whatever is inside, considerably inside Poland, those are worst in Hungary. And finally, my last slide is doing business, the most problematic factors for doing business. For Poland, it is tax regulations. That is seems to be the most frequently mentioned. For Hungary, it is policy instability. In other words, the government changing its policies and coming up with all kinds of non-conventional approaches, and also corruption. Okay, this is my presentation. Anybody, in the class, you can have access to these slides. I posted them on the Moodle. For anybody who is a visitor would like to have your card, I'd be glad to send you these slides if you're interested. Okay, next person would be, I think, you, right? Yeah, okay.
Thank you very much for your invitation. My name is Marcin Sowa and I'm commercial counselor in Polish embassy. I lead the so-called commercial section of Polish embassy, but the name is, of course, completely different. Our main mission here in Hungary is helping Polish companies, especially SMEs, on the Hungarian market. And excuse me for my poor English, because my first foreign language is Hungarian. So I usually don't use central English language here in Hungary, but I hope I will be understandable. I just prepared a few slides. So I don't know if anyone been in Poland. So it's a big country, nearly 40 million people. Big one, the sixth in Europe, with the total GDP in 2011 about 1,525 billion Polish zloty. What is as it was all told by Professor Marar, Poland succeed during the last years, and Poland was the only country without recession during the crisis. But of course, Poland, it's not a country without problems. So we have a slowdown in Polish economy also. GDP in 2012 was only 2%. For us, it's a slowdown. Maybe for Hungary, it is the aim. But for us, of course, it. Why Poland? So why investors go to Poland and invest their money? Get away to EU and to Europe, but also Hungary used to say about itself that it's a getaway in Euro. So, but of course, it's one of the possibilities. What now? It's I think what we have to underline: economic and political stability. Poland now has. It was the first time in our modern history that the same government was voted for the next period. So now we have a government who led the country for 6 years. Availability of skilled human resources, it will be taught in the later. And of course, effective incentive system, including EU funds. Of course, the market growth and big market is also very important question. But we have to remember that big market are also big problems. And for example, France and Germany are much bigger economies than Poland, and there was a recession in 2008. A few slides about how Poland, how the foreign investors treats Poland. So Ernst & Young estimated that for foreign investments, Poland is the second best country in Europe, exactly after Germany. It is the third place for industrial investments in the world, and the first one in Poland. And of course, it's on the sixth place globally by the UNCTAD. Of course, the development of the country during the last years, it was one of the highest in the world. It was made for the period 2007 and 2011. So Poland was on the fifth place, and our neighbors are India, China, Argentina, Indonesia, and Taiwan. Of course, not only Poland, but also its capital has a very good image. It was estimated as one of the 15th best city to invest in the world. And also in terms of institutions, friendships for investors, it took good fourth place in Europe. One of the Polish mode specialities is so-called BPO, so centers. Most of the investors recently are in these BPOs. During the last 6 years, about 360 companies established outsourcing centers in Poland, and because of this big number of companies, about 200,000 people works in Polish BPOs. The BPO market in Poland is estimated as 2 billion euro a year, and it will be double in 3 or 4 years. Polish Krakow, the third city of Poland, is on the 10th position all over the world to establishing BPO in the world. Poland has also the lowest corruption in Central European countries. It's a very it's fantastic data, but usually Poles used to say that it's different, but I think it's a good sign. Not only the also in Central European area, Polish regions, we have 16 big regions in Poland, so the four of them are in the first 10 in terms of investment attractivities, and two of them are on the first place. Not only the regions, but also big cities as well. There are five Polish cities in first 10 in terms of FDI attractiveness. I just collected here some, I think, useful information. So the mobile telephony services penetration just reached 135%. More than 10,000 Polish engineers works in research and development centers for the biggest IT companies in the world. There are 50,000 ITC companies in Poland, and ITC sector creates about 4% of Polish GDP. For example, the same is with the Polish furniture industry. The main the success of Polish economy is also because of variety of Polish economy. So we produce much more things, and we have much more services, and no one is in the main position. So the crisis in one sector, of course, depends on all the economy, but there is no leader sector. For example, Poland is the biggest LCD flat screens producer in Europe. 90% of European production is settled down in Poland, and the biggest producers of this equipment have their production facilities in Poland. For example, from these 50,000 ITC companies, 200 of them took part in CeBIT in Germany. From Hungary, it was 12. So this is the comparison of abilities of this company market. As I told, human resources was one of the most important thing we have in Poland. As I told, we 38 and a half million people live in Poland. 20 million are under 35. We have 2 million students. Every year about 300 or 400,000 students graduated a year. We have 18 universities, 22 technical, polytechnical university, and the number of high school in Poland is 460. So we have more students, for example, than in France, which is much more bigger than Poland. Language knowledge, I am the exception, maybe in this term, but really I remember in 1989 when I arrived first time to Hungary, and we tried to buy anything, and we tried to speak in English. It was impossible to communicate. So despite I've graduated here in Hungary, in Gdyli, it was impossible to communicate in English. Now it's much better, but it's, of course, much, much better in Poland. state aid, but I think state aid is not so interested. Interesting. Everywhere in Europe, everywhere in EU, the terms are very similar. What is Polish one of the Polish specialties is that so-called special economic zones, when there are special permission and permissions and special benefits investors gain, which is more important. There is plots and land are prepared to invest, and there is a free assistance in dealing with any formalities. As Professor Merer told, it's not easy in Poland to gain building permission, but if you want to invest in these special zones, it's much easier. Of course, EU told that when we entered to EU, it was 14 such zones, and EU didn't let to be more. But we in Poland, we managed to find a solution of this fact, and we established so-called subzones, and the number of subzones now it's more than 200. So everywhere big investor want to invest, Polish government established subzone, and that's why investing, for example, investing in Poland, it's much easier than somewhere else. About taxes, corporate income tax is 19%, personal taxes are 18 and 42, but about 85% of taxpayer pays 18. Which is very important, for example, for tourists, the value-added taxes is 23, but food is 8 or 5%, not 27 as in Hungary. So also bars, restaurants, food here is also only at 8%. Foreign investment flow to Poland until 2011 was very pretty. In 2012 it was a big degree. I think investment not exceeded 3 billion euros, so maybe it will be the one of the lowest figure in this diagram. But even in the crisis in 2008-2009, this FDI inflow was about of or more than 2 billion, 10 billion. Or as I told, Poland is uses European funds very pretty. For example, what we have reached number of kilometers of highway and motorway, or for example the wastewater treatment in Warsaw, which was added last Friday, so one of the biggest one in Europe and one of the modest in Europe. Some comparison, because Ms. Dora asked me to make such a few slides of comparison. This is the GDP growth, investment outlay, construction industry. Although it's very difficult to gain permission to build, we built. So I couldn't imagine what it would be if it will be much easier. Of course, that last year was a small degree, but it's also because of very high base of 2011. Retail sales. And Polish and Hungarian foreign trade, so we reach a level of 6 billion and 500 million euro Polish export is much higher than Hungarian, and the Polish surplus it's about 1 billion euro. Thank you for your attention.
I've been to Poland a couple of times, which doesn't make me an expert on Poland. I probably learned more about Poland in the last two presentations than I knew before. And to the shock of everybody, I'm not going to use overhead slides. So what I decided I would do, and you're probably sick of this by now, is to talk about how one would think about going to Poland. And so Dora, being very persuasive, said, well, why don't you talk about segmentation and international marketing and that sort of stuff, which is what I'm going to do. So we will start off with this thing here. You all probably recognize that this is Long's product. David and Long and I are in the process of preparing a case on this, so I know a little bit about glasses. Another one of their product is this one, which I will just quickly show you, and then we'll... I won't put this one on because it's a woman's fashion. Well, I will put it on. But this is for the fashion market. So what we're going to do, and what I thought I would do, especially for the students, we've talked in class about mind maps or logic loops or things of that sort, but we've never done one. So we're going to start off our discussion by putting on here Poland. Okay, and way over here in China, we've got a plant called Sensilu. Okay, this is in China. And sort of apologies to the people who are from the public if they thought they'd get a Polish statistical presentation. This is not what they're going to get. Now, just for the record, we'll just do one more thing here. Sensilu has established itself in Hungary as the center for their distribution. And so with all the good things you've heard about Poland, you might ask the question, why didn't they go to Poland? It's a bigger market, it's a faster growing market. Why didn't they go to Poland? And the answer is that they have a distributor in Poland, and they didn't want to upset the distributor by moving into Poland and competing with them. Just for interest, though, if you get to the distributor, you're really looking at indirect export. The distributor came to China and selected and bought product for Poland. So once you sell and to a distributor in an indirect export, one of the things you totally lack is information. Just give them the glasses, and then you don't know what happens after that. So then they came to Hungary to establish themselves in Hungary. And of course, the question is, why did they come to Hungary? Or why did they decide to move? What would they hope to accomplish in Hungary? And it should be kind of obvious why they came here. They wanted to make money, okay? So that's one of the things that they're going to look at, or one of the indicators is how much can they do in sales to Hungary. How do they get money? And again, for the students, who have heard all of this stuff before, and I'm just trying to show how it all fits together. they have to get some sustainable competitive advantage. They gain money through sustainable competitive advantage. What does that mean? It means that you have to do a competitive analysis. Lo and behold, what would you do? You do a competitive analysis. Who else is where, and what is their competitive advantage? They can do all kinds of analysis, like, for example, in high perceived value and low delivered cost model. You've got some people up here, which are the basic brand name, brand equity product. You've got some people out here, which today is coming from the Philippines as opposed to China. And so you've got Sensulu kind of sitting in here, which is not a very good place for them. Or if you want to put it into the Porter's competitive advantage, if you've got differentiation and cost and focus, guess where they are? They're sitting in the middle. So it's not exactly a great place for them. Now, at this end of it, of course, I'm assuming, because this is a Polish, or supposedly a Poland seminar, that we should talk about Poland. But of course, we should also talk about other countries. Where should they be going? And for example, some of the ones that they are considering is Italy, Portugal, and Spain. Why are they considering Italy, Portugal, and Spain? There's more sunshine per year in those countries than in Poland. Of course, because of that, you might also have much more competition. Now, I want to do a little game here. So let me start off by looking at rummaging through my things. I keep getting all kinds of product through my children. This one says on it, Swiss Army. And what's interesting on it is the hinges in the middle. Do you think Swiss Army or Victorinox made this product? No way. In fact, they probably have no control over it. So it means that it was done for them through some kind of an outsourcing possibility, quite likely in China. And again, it's sort of interesting that in sunglasses, the frame determines the product quality as much as the lenses. So for example, in this one, you've got metal frame, which is more sturdy. And so there are opportunities for them in developing for other brands. You'd have to identify what kind of brand equity you can have in Poland. This one is sort of an interesting one. It's very light. So it's not really, it protects from UV, but not from sunlight. What does the difference between these two tell me? People wear it for different purposes. And just to make it even more evident, I dug this one up, which I hate to admit I've probably owned for about 45 years. It's my Glacier glasses. And again, on this one, what is critical is that you don't get too much sunlight through it, which is why it's also striped so the reflection from the snow doesn't come up. So these are product in use features, which tells me what? And remember, there are only two answers in my classes. So what does this, and one of them is in fact on the flyer. What does it tell me? Segmentation. There we go. Segmentation. Okay, so the market is segmented in a lot of different ways, but one of them is product in use. And so getting back to some segmentation issues, for example, oh, Now, one of the things that they are trying to do is to establish brand equity by putting a name on this product, Elite, which is kind of a neat name because it links to Elite and Light and all sorts of other stuff. Nevertheless, they will never establish brand equity compared to the major players. So going the brand equity route, even in a place, well, Poland, like everybody else, the top end of the market takes its lead from people who travel a lot. So the markets look very similar, and there's no way they're ever going to be able to establish brand equity. Although you would have to have a fairly careful view of what's going on in Poland. This one is a fashion item. And the fashion market segments itself in two ways. Fashion for self or fashion for others. In others, are you buying this because you will feel better because what you're doing or because you want others to notice? Now, again, I don't know what the numbers are, and of course we know that for effective segmentation you'd have to have numbers. And how would you gain those numbers? Okay, so now we've got two of our major themes on. So for the fashion market, there is no way that you're going to be able to attract the fashion for others market. So there are a lot of things that you might want to consider. So what we're looking at here is segmentation. And at the same time, how are we going to learn about segmentation, market research? And there is one other thing that we want to throw in here to make it more international is culture. And these are all sort of interrelated. Okay? And then, of course, we get back to the problem we had here with no information, and we want to link back here that not only do you want to make money, you want to have more control over what you do. So by being able to, So by being able to do your own thing, your own distribution, you're going to gain more control. So money is not the only thing, but control becomes also part of it. And of course, once we start talking about money and control, then we have to put here our famous four-piece of marketing, which will link all of this together. In other words, that's going to be our basis for developing a marketing plan for Poland. And, you know, you want to look at, for example, in culture, you want to look at youth. And, of course, we've been told that Poland has a very large under 35 population, so the youth market would become very attractive here. If it's anything like Hungary, not only has it got a high youth population, but the youth also have the money, the young professionals. So you'd be able to segment on that basis and preferences. And there may be some cultural issues in what kind of sunglasses one would wear. So that, in a sense, is what a mind map looks like. Or how would I think about entering the Polish market? Having a number of tools available to me, which I picked up at the CEU. So that's my presentation, my non-Polish presentation for today.
Thank you.
I'm a native of Hungarian. I did my MBA in Cleveland, Ohio, a very big Hungarian city in the United States. And just looking at you really brings back all my very nice memories of those days because I used to go to a very, very international class. So this is a very, very interesting time. Nielsen is a market research company mainly focusing on FMCG companies, so companies, either drug or food category companies, who manufacture fast-moving consumer goods like food, drugs, shampoo, personal care, stuff like that. So what I'm going to be talking about basically three major things. What are consumers in Poland and in Hungary think about their way of life, their expenditure, what the general FMCG trends are in these two countries compared to Europe, for example. And then at the end of the presentation, I'm going to be talking about the trade channel in both countries and also private labels, which is actually a very big thing in FMCG trends. Just very briefly about opportunities. This is based on August 2012 data, and we believe that in Central Eastern Europe there's a huge growth opportunity. In the Eurozone it's about 70%, so we believe that in this region, Central Eastern Europe, the growth rate potential is about twice as high as Europe total. Talking about GDP, and we did cover this in the previous presentations, basically in Poland we think that the GDP is around 1 or 2%. In Hungary, unfortunately, this is in the minus trend, so negative trend, and in 2012 the GDP in Hungary was about 1% minus. Talking about what consumers think about different things in Europe and in these two respective countries, basically consumer confidence, which is a very, very important and major major thing that we at Nielsen analyze. Consumer confidence basically consists of three things: what consumers think about their own personal prosperities or opportunities in the next 12 months, what they think about their job perspectives, and whether they think that the time is a good time for bigger investments like housing, electrical supplies, cars, and so on. The maximum of this confidence index is 200. If we look at the European average, we see that it's around 70%. So it's not, well, European people are not very optimistic in general. If we look at Poland, we see that this is fairly below the European average, but pretty much in line with what other European people think. Now, looking at Hungary, we see that these numbers are actually very, very low. It did pick up in the past two quarters, but actually Hungary is the last but one in terms of confidence index in Europe, followed by Greece. So as you live here in Hungary, you probably know quite many Hungarian people. We are usually said that Hungarian people are very, very pessimistic. Even our anthem is very, very pessimistic. Now we can see it here in the data. And the reason consumer confidence index is important, because we think that there's a correlation between confidence index and what actually people spend in FMCG markets. So when these trends pick up, then people will buy more because they think that it's a good time and they feel more more confident in spending. Looking at different things, what Polish and Hungarian people think as their biggest concern, maybe as opposed to the European average. Well, talking about Hungary, 40% of Hungarian consumers asked said that they don't have any spare cash, and 21% of them, and it's way the lowest or the highest figure in the neighboring countries, and about close to three times more than the European average. Debt is the number one concern for Hungarian consumers. Regarding Polish consumers, 19% say that they don't have any spare cash. And regarding increasing food prices, they say 11% of them say that it is a big concern. A short comparison on average monthly spending by country. This is an FMCG product. European countries, including Poland and Hungary. Poland, Polish people do spend about 200 euros per month on FMCG food in comparison with Hungary, which is less than 140%. European average, we see about 330. And from this amount, it's pretty much in line in all countries in Europe that about 45-50% of these FMCG money is spent on food, on fresh food. Still talking about consumers in Europe and in the two respective countries, promotion sensitivity is getting more and more important, not only in this region of Europe and but other countries as well, or other regions as well. And what is very striking that for Hungarian consumers, the biggest or the most important thing as opposed to other countries and as opposed to Poland is that Hungarian consumers change stores based on where the biggest or the best promotion is. So it's very, very important for Hungarians. That was 2011. And 2012, we see that it's pretty much the same. So for Hungarian people, this is the number one thing. They are very, very promotion sensitive, more than the Polish people. Now, still talking about Europe, some respective countries, and also the global figures, we see that Hungarian people and Greek and the people in Greece say that they spend or they switch to cheaper products most as opposed to other countries, which for our clients, for FMCG manufacturers, is a very, very important thing, and they really need to be prepared for that. In case of Poland, this is pretty much an average, so not as striking as in case of Hungary. Regarding price sensitivity, and that's the latest data, Q4 of last year, basically what people think about prices, Poland is pretty much in the higher up, so over 25% of Polish consumers say that price changes, price increases of FMCG products is very, very important for them. In case of Hungarian people, it's not that an important thing, but if we look at price changes, it's about 6% on total FMCG level. In Hungary, we ordered about 90 categories, combination of drug and food categories. And if we just think about food categories and all the changes that happened in the past 2 years or 2.5 years in Hungary regarding VAT, regarding the so-called netta, the tax, the special tax on unhealthy food containing fat, sugar, salt. A lot of our clients, a lot of our manufacturers were actually hit very hard on this because of the new taxes. We've seen what consumers think about different things on FMCG trends in Hungary and in Poland. Regarding general FMCG trends, and this is a Europe figure, the past 3 years on the left-hand corner and then the quarterly figures, we actually see that as a total, Europe is struggling to find volume. So it's a very, very big concern. And if you look the same figure on respective countries in Europe, we see that actually Poland has very, very healthy growth in terms of both volume and value. If you look at Hungary on the other side, we see that there's a decrease in terms of volume. If you look at specifically for Hungary and then in a minute on Poland, we see that actually not only in the past 2 years, but quarter by quarter, our FMCG sales volume is going down, both on a yearly and on a quarterly basis. And what is even more threatening for Hungary, that in Q4s, which is a very, very seasonal quarter in Hungary for FMCG products, both seasonal categories, confectionery, alcoholic drinks, in drug categories, the so-called Christmas package, so everything for your mom or for your for a partner. Even in Q4s, we see that that volume didn't manage to pick up, but it was on a negative trend. Looking at the same figures in Poland, we see very, very healthy growth, both in terms of volume and value, both quarterly and yearly basis. Regarding the top 20 food categories that we audit at different countries, we see that, and if you compare Hungary and Poland, we see that actually more categories in Poland managed to grow at a higher rate, so 18 categories out of 20, than in case of Hungary. And Hungary, seven categories didn't manage to grow, but they were kind of static, so around negative or zero trend. This was the first one was in value, and this is about volume. We see that not a lot of categories managed to grow in volume, but still, in case of Poland, the growth rate was more positive in case of more categories. Talking about channel dynamics, which is very, very important. So it is important for the manufacturers, for our clients, to know what people think, the consumers think, because they can better target, they can better reach the consumers. But it also is very important to see where the consumers spend their money. So channel dynamics is very, very important, and the abbreviations here are hypermarkets, supermarkets, and the remaining, so the traditional trade. And obviously, looking at the UK, where hypermarkets are very, very important, in case of Hungary and Poland, we see a little bit different trends. And if we look at our respective countries, we see that in case of Poland, hypermarket share was 16%, as opposed to Hungary, 38%. So traditional trade is very, very important in lots of parts of Eastern Central Europe, and it's very important in Poland as well. Regarding FMCG outlet type importance, and this is about food categories audited in Hungary, we see, and this is on a yearly basis, we see that the number one point of sales in terms of FMCG retail sales is hypermarkets in Hungary. But if we look at yearly figures, we see some kind of a drop in importance at the advantage of discounters that are getting more and more important, not only in Hungary, but in other parts of the world as well. Looking at how the number of stores have changed in Hungary, we pretty much see that there were some hypermarkets opening, not really, in case of drugstores, it's pretty much stable. In supermarkets, there was a shift in Kaiser belonging to Spar and stuff like that. But if we look at discounters, we see that in case of Hungary, discounters are getting more important in terms of numbers. If you look at the same or pretty much the same figures for Poland, we see that large formats, so non-traditional outlet type formats, take about 51%, so a very, very hard share, but sport format takes about another 47-48%. So traditional trade is important in Poland. And if we look at how modern trade has changed in Poland, we see that the top two chains in hypermarkets Carrefour, with 69 stores, pretty much the same on a yearly basis, Tesco and Kaufland, managed to open new stores. What I think is very, very striking, if we look at discounters in Poland, actually the numbers are just striking, because in Hungary we have about 500 discounters, and it's just very, very many here in Poland. But if you look at Biedronka, I don't know if I pronounce it well, the Portuguese chain, actually the number of stores grew by over 15% on a yearly basis, and it's pretty much the same in case of Lidl, which is present in several Eastern Central European countries. And also in case of Aldi, we see that newer and newer stores were opened. This is basically the number of stores opening and the share of sales. And why we see in red that the Europe average is pretty much so. New stores are open, new discounters are opening. Obviously, their shares are going to be more important. But in case of Poland, this is even so. By one new discounter store, it's getting actually more and more important. And it's pretty much the same in case of Hungary. Private label development. Private label is basically a product that's not branded. It's owned by Lidl, Tesco, Aldi. It either has the name on it, or it just has distributor Lidl, or maybe it doesn't even say the name in case of DM products, for example. What we see, private labels or retailer brands, that in all parts of Europe, it's a very, very big and trendy thing. In case of the UK and Switzerland, their share is really very, very high, about 40%. So even if we think, let's say, of Marks and Spencer in case of UK, so maybe stores wouldn't even think that they have private labels. But in these parts of Western Europe, they are very, very important. If we look at our respective countries, Hungary and Poland, we pretty much see in Poland it's 16%, and in Hungary it's about 22%. So that's general and in terms of value. What we see, and unfortunately I don't have the up-to-date 2012 data yet, but if we compare several countries, over 2,000 categories in seven countries, we see that in terms of both volume and value, private shares are picking up year by year at a very, very dynamic way. If we look at pretty much the same trends in Hungary, and we have the top mega categories in terms of food and non-food that we audit in Hungary, we see that the 22%, as we have seen in case of Hungary, sometimes mean 45 and 50%. So in case of frozen food and pet food categories, this share, private label share, is really very, very high, about 40 or 50%. And in case of drug categories, we audit household paper, for example, is over 40%. So it's very, very much scattered around the different categories. If we look at private label growth in Poland, we see that while FMCG categories total, that is audited by Nielsen in Poland, the growth rate was close to 7% on a yearly basis. Out of this, branded goods managed to grow by 4%, and private labels grew by over 20%. And if you look at the different outlets, we see that basically their growth is outraged by branded goods very, 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 very much. What is the main reason for consumers buying private labels? Well, no wonder, because they cost less than branded goods. But also what I think is important, that they really offer a very good value for money ratio, and also that a lot of consumers in these countries think that the quality of private label products is pretty much the same than branded goods. Just two closing remarks, and one is what we as FMCG manufacturers, both global and local, we don't need to be threatened about private labels, because looking at some very, very big European markets and the US market, we see that although the number one brands in the respective countries are still very, very important, and retailer brands in green are growing yearly by yearly, but most of the cases they take shares from other brands, so B brands or number two, number three brands, and not the number one brands, which is very, very important for our manufacturers, for our clients. As a closing remark, and this I believe is valid for both countries, both Poland and Hungary, that we have been experiencing very, very tough environment, tougher in Hungary than in Poland. We, as a company serving manufacturers, FMCG manufacturers, think that winning against the major branded competitors is great. The manufacturers need to follow more the shoppers because shopper preferences are getting more and more important and change a lot. And also branded goods and retailer brands, they both can survive in the same market. And for manufacturers, branded goods manufacturers, it's very, very important to think in the proper way. So that was my presentation. Thank you very much.
Switch from FMCG goods, from FMCG to real estate. I don't know how many of you are familiar with this sector. The presentation will not be necessarily a comparison between the two countries. I'm neutral, I'm Romanian, so I don't want to compare necessarily the two countries, but from the presentation, I couldn't help myself not to notice that our development trend follows basically what Mr. Maher emphasized previously.
Sorry, do you have a presentation you have? That we can maybe put it there.
This is real estate, basically, always a big plan. So to answer to your question, we didn't have particular problems with the building permits in Poland. We did have some, but I wouldn't categorize them being extraordinary or being bigger than we did have problems with building permits in Romania or in Croatia or in Slovenia. So I don't think Poland is any worse than these other countries. So as I said, this is not mine. It will not be a comparison between the two countries, but I cannot help myself to notice that, as Mr. Mara said in his presentation, there are fundamental differences between Hungary and Poland if you judge the two periods of time, meaning that Hungary was a leading country in mid-90s or early 90s, and then Poland became the leading country somewhere starting with 99 or 2000. Okay, one can say that it was quite normal to have Hungary in our portfolio more dominant because this is basically our home country, because we are Hungarian developer. But then slowly you realize from the presentation that things started to change. And today, in TriGranit's portfolio, Poland occupies number one. Number one as a volume of investment, number one as a number of projects, number one in volume of work, and so on. So we were founded, a couple of words about TriGranit just to get familiarized with what we do and who we are. We were founded in 99. Our main appetite is to develop mixed urban projects, meaning that we put together retail, offices, hotel, even social projects. We think that we are one of the most important developer in this part of the region, which covers also successfully Russia, which is not an easy country, I should say. We do have projects in partnership with any other investor, with other investors, basically. We can do it on our own as well. Today, we actually, if you follow the record, we have invested more than 2 billion euro in our projects over the time in the 15 years of existence. And today we are present in the 9 countries. You will see them later on a map. The last one, which is not unfortunately present there, is Macedonia. We just signed a development consultancy agreement with one of the Slovenian developers who would like to have a mixed urban development in Skopje, the capital of the country.
We do mainly retail, meaning shopping centers, meaning malls. That's why we have mentioned here that we have more than 3,500 tenants in our portfolio. The main headquarters is in Budapest. We have over 420 employees. We have a sister company called TriGranit Management. They take care of property and facility management, as well as leasing, being our number one leasing agent. The number one strength that we have is that we can provide to any third party the full range of services in the real estate development, meaning acquisition and investment, development itself, asset management, which is basically the job of our brothers from TGM. The asset management obviously comes into the scheme after the asset is open, the shopping center or the office building or the hotel. Then we do, as I said, leasing, again through our leasing agent, TriGranit Management. We can assist our clients to obtain corporate financing. Okay, it's a little bit more difficult these days, we all know that, but not impossible, depending very much on projects. And then we can do the marketing and PR. Marketing and PR before opening, and marketing and PR after the opening of the asset. These are our shareholders. I don't want to insist too much on this slide, just only one very important detail. Mr. Sandor Demian is a co-founder of this school, together with Mr. George Soros. So, Imofinance is the one other developer, a very big developer in this part of the of this part of Europe, and they are our shareholders as well. This is the map that I was talking about. So we cover most of the CEE. As I said, Macedonia is, I don't want to be wrong, I think is this one here somewhere. I don't want to conquer any other country saying that it's Macedonia to create an international conflict.
Don't you show again, I can tell you if it is.
This one?
Yeah.
So we are present in the Russian Federation. We do have a shopping center there which we want to enlarge. Looking for investors, by the way. Anyone in the room? peanuts. Couple of tens of millions. So, as I said, and based on the number of red dots, based on the number of red dots on the map, Poland is our main main market today. And referring to what Mr. Sowa just mentioned. Yes, we are present in one of the most important European cities. I saw the classification that you had. So we are present in, we were present actually in Katowice because we sold the project. We are present in Krakow with our shopping center and the office compound. And we have a scheme under development in Poznan. We will see some details a little bit later. We are present in Bratislava. Obviously, we are present in Hungary, Slovenia, Croatia. As I said, Macedonia, our new baby born. We used to be present in Romania with two projects. We sold them both as well. But who knows, we might come back because Romania is the second country in the region after Poland. Some milestones or key dates, let's say, during the crisis, obviously, since consumption was heavily affected by the crisis, and since we deal somehow with the consumption as well, building malls for the stores for the people to consume, so since this consumption was decreased, we were also affected. You have, I wouldn't necessarily read all of them, but you have the most important key dates for us during the years of crisis until 2013. I'll mention only 2013, we have opened the third phase of B4B, Bonarka for Business, in Krakow. Actually, it's the third building, and we have under construction the fourth one today. And the topping out ceremony for Poznan City Center, which is going to be open somewhere mid-October this year. what we build and what is our preference. As I said, we build mixed urban developments. We build mixed urban, we develop actually mixed urban projects. Coincidentally or not, we like to build these projects next to train stations. We have this, maybe since you live in Budapest, maybe you know West End shopping center. It was built next to a Nyugati train station, incorporating somehow and creating a synergy between the shopping center office and Hilton Hotel on one side and the train station on the other side. Because, you know, transportation infrastructure is very important. We have certain criterias and key characteristics to be taken under consideration when we decide to develop a certain project. The real estate people say that you have the first top three important criteria when you start a real estate development are location, location, and location. So basically, this would be the number one criteria. Everybody wants to be in the city center, but you can find also successful project being developed not necessarily in the city center, but also in the outskirts. I know it's not a US model. Europeans are a little bit lazier than the Americans. We don't travel to the end of the city to do shopping in Zara or in, I don't know, Tesco. We prefer to have it next door, to jump from the balcony if possible. what is very important, because we think about the future for each and every project, we would like to have expansion possibilities. And from the statistic, we have developed until now 836,000 square meters of GBA. GBA meaning gross buildable area. Follows the same pattern, so basically it continues the key characteristics enumeration. These are very important when we assess a potential project, as I said. I'll not enter into too many details. We do offices as well. If you have a decent walk on the alongside Danube, you will realize next to Petőfi Híd a very nice compound of offices where Vodafone has the headquarters. This is ours. We are the developers. Now we are co-owners because we sold part of it. So there are certain parameters or criteria to be followed also when it comes about offices. You know, it's very important. Again, location is not as important as in retail. In offices, for example, it's good to build where somebody else already built a project because you create a cluster. In retail, you want to build as far as possible from the competition, not to share the catchment area. So it's a little bit different. Again, some statistic. This is the social component of our development, which is very, very important for TriGranit and especially for our shareholder, for Mr. Damian. He is heavily involved in these social activities, foundations, charity, and so on. We are very proud to mention always when we talk about our social projects, the two most important buildings in Budapest, which were the result of a PPP together with the Hungarian government, meaning maybe you recognize them from the picture. Sorry to point my finger. This is the National Theater, and this is the Palace of Arts. So both of them are our projects, basically together with, as I said, with the Hungarian authorities. We did residential, but I have to admit here in front of you that this is not our core business. Is it not interesting? I can make some more jokes. I lost him. So we do residential as well. This is not our core business, as I said. Coincidentally, when I moved to Budapest, without knowing that this is a TriGranit project, I moved into one of the apartments here. This is Dunapest Rezidenciok, sorry, my Hungarian. And we do hotel as well. Actually, in Skopje, for example, the master plan reads retail, offices, and the hotel. We did Hilton here next to, actually incorporated in West End. Poland, because this is the object, right, of our discussion. As I said, we had three important projects in Poland. We had Katowice, one of the most developed industrial areas in Poland. We have developed here Silesia City Center, which was sold later on. You have also some statistics. Now Silesia already opened a second phase, so the new owner already developed our scheme and attached a second phase to it. This is Bonarka City Center, which is the largest TriGranit shopping center, located in Krakow. This is the shopping center here, which is lovely. This is my favorite project in TriGranit portfolio. And these are the three office buildings. This is the last one open. So now we have another one in construction, which hopefully next week will be pre-leased to Lufthansa entirely. Then Poznan City Center, which is today under construction. If you remember, I have mentioned our appetite to build next to train stations. This is Poznan Glovny, which is the name of the train station. It means the main, right, or the most important one. We have incorporated in the shopping center two the most important hubs, train hubs and bus terminal. So then again, the same synergy to be created and to take advantage of the traffic generated by the train station and the bus terminal. Of course, here we don't invent the hot water. Everybody wants to do the same. So we have refurbished the train station, and which was inaugurated already last May. And the bus terminal will be inaugurated together with the rest of the shopping center, as I said, in October this year. You know, as any company, I wouldn't necessarily bother you to list our values and our strong success factors. I just want to tell you that today we sit on a huge amount of know-how, which we try to use it not necessarily as an investor and developer, but also as a fee developer. This is why we have signed this Skopje partnership, because we have a lot of professional people and we would like to take advantage of this fact. These are, you know, lately they always talk about sustainable development and green buildings and LEED and BREEAM. Maybe you are familiar with all these certificates. Everybody is or pretend that it is very careful with the environment. We are careful. Not only, I mean, without being hypocrites, it is very important these days to have these green certificates, because it's, first of all, you know, you do involve yourself into the community realities, and also it's much more easier to sell the project at a certain point in time. These are some of the prizes that we gained during the years. Again, I'll not bother you to list all of them. We got a lot of recognition from certain authorities, public or private authorities. And this is the most important slide. Thank you.